Good evening, everybody, and welcome to tonight's regularly scheduled Planning Commission meeting of October 24th, 2012. Have a roll.
Commissioner Kuzner. Commissioner Kite. Commissioner Bush.
Here.
Vice Chair Coates.
Here.
Chairman Manfredi.
Here.
For the record, Commissioner Kuzner is absent.
Would everyone stand, please, for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States Republic, my nation, God.
The right to see, which is public comments. Public comments is time reserved on each regular meeting agenda provide an opportunity for the public to directly address the Planning Commission on items of interest to the public that do not appear on the agenda. Comments should be limited to 2 minutes. The Commission will not be able to take action on items raised in the public comment.
Clarence Levisi, 285 Rosedale Road. I may have missed it in going over the city budget, so I'm not sure where it's located. But I was told there was the Affordable Housing Trust Fund and the Parking Trust Fund. And I was wondering where those funds are budgeted and where we see the amounts that are in them. Because affordable housing is being discussed tonight, and I was wondering what funds are in that account, and are they going to be used for this? I haven't had a chance to look through the document completely yet. But in regard, whether or not about tonight's discussion, I'm interested in those two funds, and I've asked different people and in the community, and they don't know either. So I was wondering if I could get a response either from Planning Department or yourselves.
Not tonight. Want to give a very
yeah, those are budgeted in separate funds. The fees we collect for in lieu fees on projects are deposited in a fund for affordable housing, and same with our in lieu parking fees. I don't have those budget figures with me. I can get them to you tomorrow.
Were they in the regular budget, or are they simply in a separate category budget? A special budget?
They're in the special revenue section of the budget.
Okay, then I just missed them, right? Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, we'll close the public comment. The motion to adopt the agenda.
Motion to adopt.
Favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? So, one late pick. Consent calendar, we need a motion. Calendar as sent.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Mm.
Aye. All opposed? Don't have any tours of inspection. But we'll go right to section I, which is new business. Have one item tonight, and that's Calistoga Affordable Housing / the Oaks. Do a review of revised conceptual development plans to construct an 18-unit affordable housing project located at 611 Washington Street, APN 011-260-027 within the R3 Residential Professional Office Zoning District. The applicant is Calistoga Affordable Housing. On behalf of the property owner, Charles Gonzalez. This project was first presented to the Planning Commission on July 25th, 2000.
Chair Manfredi, my office is located within the 300-foot radius of this project, so I will recuse myself at this time.
Okay. Okay, thanks. Good evening, Walter is here.
Thank you.
Sorry, I'm late.
Right. Let me give you a second. But we're right about to start the new business. Okay.
Thank you.
So with that, Eric, unless there's any questions right now?
I'll be giving the staff report, Chairman and Freddie. That's okay. As you mentioned, on July 25th, the Planning Commission received a presentation from Calistoga Affordable Housing for conceptual development plans to construct an 18-unit affordable housing project on Lower Washington Street. As described in the staff report and as the commission will recall, the commission raised a number of areas of concern, including project density, the proposed number of parking spaces and configuration of parking, neighborhood compatibility and consistency with the vision of the city's urban design plan, an interest or concern about the lack of common area or green space, and an interest in exploring or concern about not having mixed uses in the project. In response to those comments, the applicant has submitted a revised set of plans which are before you tonight. Again, these are conceptual plans. We're not seeking any action tonight. However, the applicant is wanting to get your feedback on the response that they've made to the comments from the July 25th meeting. That response, I'm not going to go into detail. I believe the applicant and his consultant team is here to go through the changes. I'll just highlight some of them. The project has been changed so that development is more oriented towards Washington Street, facing onto the street rather than siding onto it. They have included now a office space on the ground floor at the front of the project site. They have added green space and landscaping to the interior of the project. And they've scaled back the buildings and relocated the trash enclosure to provide more visual exposure to the creek and the view of the mountains from the site. And they have eliminated one residential unit. Staff believes these changes do represent a good faith effort to respond to the commission's comments. They haven't addressed everything, but they certainly have done a lot. The applicant's now seeking your feedback in hopes that they can finalize their plans and move forward with a formal development application. Again, this is a concept review. Your comments are not binding, but they're certainly used by staff and the applicant to consider their final plans. And with that, I think I'll conclude my report. I'll add that staff has not received any communications from surrounding neighborhoods or anybody on this project.
Thank you, Ken. Do any commissioners have any questions? Ken? Okay, the applicant like run us changes.
Larry Croman, 19 Rock Rose Lane, and representing Calistoga Affordable Housing. I've put together some statements that we have used in our research with this project concerning things, items from the general plan, the urban design plan, and the ABAG Plan Bay Area Jobs Housing Connection Strategy, which was produced in August 2012. And from that, I'm not going to read it all, but I just want to hit the high points. There is a very large need for safe, affordable housing. I think that the community is pretty much aware of this. And the target range that we are looking at is the low income. We propose to provide housing for those in the $45,000 to $65,000 income range, realizing that according to the 2010 census, the median income level for Calistoga is $50,000. So this target range is right smack in the middle. There is a need for removing regulatory barriers, particularly in the Lower Washington area, according to the general plan, the urban design plan, in order to meet the desires of the city plan, which is to have housing closer to the downtown, which takes away some of the need for parking issues. It also basically indicates that there needs to be more density in this particular area, particularly in the Lower Washington area. Calistoga is in a very unusual spot. It has more jobs than it has workers, and that then means that people are having to come into Calistoga from the outside because there isn't enough housing here to take care of that particular need. ABAG has continually monitored that, and they indicate that in the coming years, it's going to be worse than it is now. When you consider the fact that the two major resort projects that are being considered by the city right now. That's going to add to this problem by another 200 jobs. And I think the question I've heard some of you raise is, where is the housing need and the remedy for that? And part of this project is to help take care of that particular need. The stats from ABAG basically say that 44% of the city residents are part of the city's workforce. 42% have to work elsewhere because there isn't enough jobs here. Also, there needs to be, according to the documents of the city, there needs to be a more intense mixed-use development. And reading on the bottom part, it says, given these opportunities, this area concerning the lower Washington Street should be reserved primarily for more intensive mixed-use development to accommodate the variety of land uses. It also calls for reducing redundant parking. There is a large need for diverse housing projects that use different projects and types. Right now, the housing industry is changing dramatically. We have been researching the feasibility of using modular construction because it makes the project financially feasible. It also can provide very good quality, and it is something that the industry says is going to be increasing, particularly in California and the other parts of the West Coast. Parking is probably one of the greatest challenges, and another part that we have recommending is that, as you're probably aware, Calistoga Affordable Housing was recently awarded through the city a block grant of $47,000 to study senior housing. And from the study that we have already begun over a year ago on this, it appears that one of the solutions for senior housing is what they call multigenerational. In other words, you want to take seniors and put them into housing projects with other type of families. And so it creates its own little community. Having the Washington Street corridor so close to downtown, it makes it also very convenient for seniors. And it really takes away the need for additional parking because they really don't have the need for the cars. In our work with Rebuilding Calistoga, we have discovered that there are many residents in the three parks that they do not have cars, and those that have begun to get rid of them because of the high expense of that. Very few residents in the three parks have two cars. It's the need of being able to walk to what the amenities that are in the city. If you are ever down into the area around Brannan Street, you see that seniors are always walking up and down, coming downtown, which frankly is a little dangerous because of the corner that is up there of Brannan and Lincoln. The architecture has been described, and we have done quite a bit of work to try and modify the interpretation so it meets more of what the city is looking for. But it's probably in the area of senior housing that we have made the biggest change on this design. We have taken all the ground floor units and made them not just senior, these are senior handicapped, so that people who are maybe not even be senior, but that they're handicapped, there's not very many places that they can find that they can rent. So the five units, it's four units, isn't it? Four units that we have designed on the lower floor will be senior oriented and handicapped, which should take away the need for more parking. And as we read the stats that have been coming out, particularly out of ABAG, which basically says that in the next 30 years, the increase to seniors in little towns like this is going to increase 137%. That's a very large number. And I think that we need to begin planning now of how we're going to take care of that need. We've asked Eric Haslip, who is the architect on this project, to present the rest of the presentation.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone have any questions? No, actually, I do. In your cover letter covering tonight, I'm just curious. It says the topic of density was raised by several of the commissioners as well as the general public. Following discussions with staff and planning, I'm just curious. Planning commission didn't talk to me, so I'm just wondering.
I'm not sure which notes you're referring to there. What's?
It's attachment 7. It's an overview which you submitted with this packet. It lists density, parking, mixed use, Calistoga character, overriding character.
Is that what I just was referring to? This wasn't included in the packet. I don't know what.
Oh, well, it. Yeah, this was in the. I was just wondering what planning commission. Oh.
Did talk to me.
I talked to Carol. I talked to Paul Coates. But I think this letter was from the July meeting that we first started. But anyway, those are the two that I have talked to personally.
I was just wondering. No, see, because it said in reviewing the minutes of the July 25th.
Okay.
Okay.
Hello, I'm Eric Hoslop from Trimble Griffin Hoslop Architects and members of the commission. First of all, I would just like to thank you for really thoughtful comments last time because they were helpful. One of the things that, as the architect, that's great for us is getting constructive feedback, and I thought we really got that. So what I'd like to do this evening is to walk through our thought process to date. We've revised the project quite a bit, and there are a number of key points that we've looked at, and some of them have to do with which Ken has outlined in the staff report, but we did look at changing, really kind of going back and looking at both the lower Washington Street, the plan, and kind of, you know, walking back through and looking at this street, because it's a really diverse street. There's a lot of different building types there. And one of the things that's interesting, which you talk about in the plan for Lower Washington Street, is that there are both really large-scale buildings, like some of the old self-storage warehouse. There's the bottling plant further down. There's the church. So you have some really big, long-span structures. And then in between that, sort of sprinkled, are a lot of really dense housing projects and one or two really beautiful old clapboard buildings that are in the mix. And so kind of taking your comments, taking the plan, looking at that, the first thing that we did is to go back and really look at the neighborhood. And of course, this really is one of the newer buildings, which is kind of trying to pick up on the idea of the mixed commercial, residential, kind of the scale, bringing something to address Washington Street and dealing with the sidewalk. And this is, of course, our immediate neighbor, Shaw's Plumbing, which is different in that it's really more service commercial and set back further from the street. That is the immediate neighbor. And then to our other side, going out towards the ball field and the bottling park, the bottling plant, there's a really dense housing development right in here. There's small scale housing development across the street, and then it gets big again. So it's an interesting thing because it's clearly going to be changing, and our project, our proposed project, is one of the things that's going to kind of help continue the change. And this is looking at site, and the other thing that is really interesting is, aside from the plan, this area actually has really beautiful geographic features. It is part of what makes Calistoga so beautiful, and you do see the mountain range, and you do actually have a view through to the river beyond here. And we also have this really nice oak and this big oak in the back that's along the river. And both of these, they happen to be diagonally opposite But so it was really trying to think about, okay, how can we take all of these things, both the sort of the envisioned piece of the neighborhood, the actual neighborhood, and really these pretty fantastic site conditions. So this is, of course, our project site, and this is a computer model that we've placed in a Google Earth, so that's what you're actually looking at. And the big change from a design perspective is that where we had a three-story piece that was along by Shaw's, we've actually moved that over to the other side, and we have four tuck-under buildings. And then we've added a building that runs along parallel to Washington Street that really talks directly to the planning guidelines and in fronts Washington Street. And the other thing that we're looking at is having low massing that makes an L, and then the taller massing is pushed further back on the site. And so the idea is that it really connects this oak with an L back to that oak, and that's the lower massing. And this was an early concept sketch, but it's really looking at the idea of getting a collective to deal with some of the larger scale pieces. It's both, there's some residential scale, and in a way the idea was that these are almost the shed buildings, and Ward and Batten is what we're thinking of, and this is more of the farmhouse, which is tucked behind it. And this was the plan, starting to look at how we could come in, how we could deal with, we have four units that have for a total of 16 car spaces in the tuck under. And then one of the comments was to increase the balconies, which we've done. We've made the porch, we've actually gone to porches for the most part. And we have a large gateway that's really to frame the view back to the river for everybody, but also to provide pedestrian access. And we made a much bigger space, sort of that a green landscape space that could lead you back, because there's a really generous area back in here that's partially just because we have a big area from the riverbank setback. And finally, we put it's an office space or a flex swing space right in here, because it's really the most public part of the site. And so that was an early study. And this was looking at ways to start to give architectural character and to think about how can we build these buildings in a way, because there's a lot of different finishes, materials, scales going on. And this was actually looking at trying to maybe think about bringing the landscape forward to the entry. It's a thought. And this is an example of, for those of you that know, this is Southbridge that we did a number of years ago. But kind of the idea of using landscape to, again, soften and settle the buildings into their site. And then, of course, this is looking, we put it in and we actually modeled it up. And so these are the CAD drawings of it. And so just to test, because it's a tight site, and so we wanted to make sure that we had 30 spaces, the units, and that we had all the handicap clearances work that we need to get to work for the lower units, which are, incidentally, this is one, this is another one, this is the third one, and that's the fourth one. So those are the four units that Larry was talking about. And then this is actually a computer rendering of it. So this is a 3D model, and it's basically showing, this is Washington Street running right along here. And so this is looking to try and get a collective doorway that comes to Washington Street, but at the same time works with the smaller scale of the individual residences. In this particular, this building that comes along the front and wraps along the back, we're hoping to use board and batten siding. Be really nice and fit in really well. Love to use a corrugated metal roof, which kind of relates to the older historic house that's kind of diagonally across the street. And then more like a traditional farmhouse, we're still thinking of sticking with the clapboard siding on the back buildings. And this is actually as good an example of a materials board as I can think of. It's a bunkhouse that we did, actually up above beyond St. Helena, but it's got the corrugated metal roof, and it's a board and batten and board, vertical board, structure. And this is looking at really the second floor, which has got the walk-up apartments that are here. So there are three units along here. So this is the second floor. This is a really nice apartment that actually stretches across with a bedroom and then sort of the central space and another bedroom right there. This is one of the one-bedroom apartments, so the two one-bedroom apartments are in this corner. And these are similar to last time. These are the tuck-under ones where each one of these is basically a townhouse that you walk up to, so each unit is two stories. So it's a nice mixture. So part of what we've done is we've actually added more unit types, which generally tends to bring more diversity and more mixture to the project. And so in many ways, the materials are more expensive that we're looking at, the roof shapes are more expensive, kind of added costs to address some of these concerns. The balconies have gotten deeper. So one of the things that we're continuing to look at, and Larry mentioned this, but architecturally we're trying to make the project look like it's always been there. But technically, we're looking at some pretty cutting edge technologies of how to build it in a very green fashion and to try and keep it affordable. And so one of the things we're looking at, this happens to be Zeta. It was a project that just went up in San Francisco. And I actually went out and met with the founder of the company to look and see how this stuff is going up and what's working. And I talked with the architect. And so we're actually right now looking at doing some form of modular construction. And the other thing I think that's worth pointing out, because it was one of the comments that came, I think, from the audience and maybe one of you from the commission, but we did really flip the entire massing. And so this gray part, so now we're looking, we're cutting through the third floor, so it's really only the taller townhouse pieces that have the third floor. This is the two-story piece that's kind of wrapping from the big oak here, kind of coming along Shaw's Plumbing, and then going along Washington Street to the other oak that's right there. And in looking at models, this of course predates things in this area, but this is the Vallejo site, one of Vallejo's early houses. But you can see that we were kind of looking again at the, you know, the porches, the gable, the clapboard. And finally, this is the last image that I have, but this is taken from the riverbank. And because we have a 35-foot setback to the top of the bank, we actually have a really pretty terrific area to develop. We haven't obviously gotten a landscape architect involved yet, but there's a great area and potential right there for playing. Added a meandering path between these units and the parking that's right here. So we have sort of the idea of the staggered bosque of trees. There's the view through the site, and then there's really these actually almost Victorian proportioned townhouses, the four of them that have eight units in them. So that's that kind of is a quick snapshot of the changes that we've made. And so I think we've tried to hit pretty much everything that everybody's raised. But you know, if you have any questions or thoughts,
does anyone have any questions? I'm the architect.
I guess a technical question. With the four accessible units, does that create a requirement for more than one accessible parking space?
It probably will. We have, so it's a very good question. Right now, the way the housing guidelines read, it's one accessible space. And what's interesting about it is because all units are required to be accessible if they're on a podium level or a ground floor level. And so even with that requirement, one parking space is the requirement right now. But you kind of wonder. But that's the way it reads. So, but it's a really good question.
Okay. I mean, an accessible space needs a lot more, takes up a lot more.
It needs four more, yeah. In fact, if we go back, you don't have the computer plans, but yeah, it's basically an 11-foot space versus an 8-foot or a 9-foot, 12-foot space. So, which actually got out of the drawing, but in the plan, the spaces were at the end, a wider space.
Kunstler?
So I just, I don't know if it's, the right question now, but so first off, just first blush, the development is a lot more visually appealing than the first one was, so thank you for that. It looks,
sure, sure.
I think that the neighborhood, and it starts to feel a little bit more upscale, if you will, and more contemporary, so that's good. And still keeping the old feeling, right? So did you change, so the setbacks from the river, has that been changed? You said that's basically from your original proposal,
the setback,
about the same?
The setback is the same.
Okay.
And what happened was I went back and looked, and if you go to where La Tienda is, the store and the mixed-use uh-huh. development, that setback is this sidewalk right here. And so we're actually, our porch is the same as the store, as the front of La Tienda, that series of stores. And I think there's a seamstress, or I can't remember. So anyway, we pushed it forward a little bit.
Okay.
So that is one of the differences.
Okay. So, and maybe Ken will answer this, maybe it's a combination. So, you know, I've heard discussions, and I have to admit I'm not fully aware of what's all been done, but there has been some interest in preserving some kind of accessibility along that river, the Napa River, and particularly at any of the new developments. Does this fit?
Yeah, you'll remember at our last meeting on this project on July 25th, that issue was highlighted in the staff report, and unless I'm mistaken, and Eric or Larry will correct me, the applicant has indicated a willingness to provide an easement for future construction of a bike path. We don't have the alignment exactly of that bike okay. path, so if you're wondering how much of that play area is cut off by a bike path,
yeah, so
we don't.
Yeah, I was kind of looking at that back area, going, I don't see a, you know, even a little dotted line
we
that says
know.
This could be a bike path, but
it'll probably be many, many years before a pathway ever goes in, so at least in the shorter term, residents of this project, should it get built, will enjoy, you know, the full use of that space in the interim.
And we actually are thinking about including some bike parking, just because this site, I mean, one of the things that is just great about this site, I mean, it's really great, is that it's an infill project. You know,
yeah.
So often these are outside someplace, or you have to extend something, and we're right in town. And so in a way, if we looked at lead points, for example, you know,
mm-hmm.
the walkability score that we would get would be really high for this site, right? And so that, or even like for the younger families, you know, having bikes or access, it's actually a terrific amenity. So I we're looking, it's modest, but we are looking at trying to provide some bike parking. So
yeah, so this kind of comes back to where, again, Ken, for you guys, on that Laura Washington there, are there any parking restrictions on the street?
There are no parking restrictions. Again, the commission discussed, and we've discussed on other projects as well. I think we're all aware there is a high demand for on-street parking in that area, especially when the church is having services.
Yeah.
By all accounts, that is the condition, but there aren't any restrictions, meaning there aren't public street spaces reserved for specific uses or businesses on the street.
So, I mean, where my concern comes in, I think there are parking issues down there, and I think it affects a whole host of people because, as we pointed out, it's a very mixed area. So I'm a little concerned about, you know, the vertical parking, some of those spots being used basically for storage and not really for parking. You know, and I guess you can't mandate. It's there for parking. If somebody decides to use it, it's their house, they decide to use it for something else. But it does impact the streets out there. So having said that, do we have any opportunity for any on-site storage for people on that might be residents there? That what I'd like to avoid, if we could, in that area, is you know, having carports filled with things other than, you know, the personal household effects.
Sure.
I like
sure.
to see it used for parking, but kind of knowing, you know, people, young families and people kind of growing up, they're going to have some issues about storage.
It's a huge thing. I think, and so the areas that we have right now are, for example, in these units, we just put a big storage closet in downstairs, and just because they're going to need it. I think we don't have it in here right now. We had it in, took it out. It's an expense item, but we had storage that was under each one of these landings right here, just because it's roughly an 8 by 10 foot area, and you have to waterproof it. I mean, you have to kind of seal it and rodent-proof and waterproof it and stuff. So it's not cheap. I mean, it's not free. But in terms of the site plan, there are some spaces that we could definitely kind of, you know, maximize, right? Some corners to develop a little bit of storage. So it's kind of like a little storage warehouse kind of thing, right, that we could fit underneath. So it's limited, but there are some nooks and crannies that are pretty good for it.
Yeah, I just like to see some creativity in helping people deal with their family.
I think what you're referring to, though, is we will have an on-site management, and this is, to me, a managerial thing in our CC&Rs and things that we put in for what the residents have to comply with. The facilities that we have now, that's what we do, and we don't have problems like that.
Okay.
I mean, if they only have one car, and that can probably be worked out, but we don't want to be taking spaces just for parking and use them for something else. It is our strong desire, we do not want to have parking spilling out on the street. We want to make it so that parking is on the site.
Yeah, and I just think that helps with the overall development of that area, of town, to make it more generally desirable. Okay, thank you.
If I could,
please. No, go ahead.
If I could pick up on Commissioner Kuzner's issue and keying off your thoughts on management and on-site management, would you have any kind of parking management plan, designated spaces? I mean, what are your thoughts? And let me be clear, I have the same concern. If what's going to happen is the first people that come in off the street are going to fill up all these spaces here.
Because I think you do have to have a parking and a management plan, and you do need to assign parking spaces in there.
Okay.
And that needs to be monitored. It's one of the things that in the three senior parks, that's what happens. Okay. It's something that when people come in, that they need to be told that up front, and it's in writing. This is what the situation is, and it's monitored.
So if you've got one of these units with the tuck under parking, that's your space. You don't get to use these spaces over here.
That's correct.
Okay.
Quick kind of question on the same subject. It's not only monitored, but is it enforceable? I mean, can you make them do it? If
I know from the parks situation, it's enforceable. Okay. I think that if you make that a condition to begin with, and that's in writing, I believe you can do that. I'm not an expert in that, but I know that in the apartments that we have on Brannan, we are able to manage that. We haven't had problems like that. But I think you need to do that up front and have a parking and a management plan, and everyone's aware of what it is, and when things get aligned, you deal with it. You don't let it grow and take off.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask one, Larry, while you're up here, can I ask you one other question? It's not a question, it's actually a statement. You know, and looking. Anyway, perhaps that affordable housing or the city could help these people that might live in those situations develop some type of off-site storage at a very reasonable cost somewhere. Because what's going to happen is people come in, they just have lots of household goods.
Yeah, that's.
And they can look at the storm. So.
And I think there are ways that we can. You've got a storage right across the street that we could work out. In the three parks, you're able to have a storage unit no more than 10 by 10. And I know because I have to deal with management and helping out some of the residents. And when they go over that or they are overloaded, we have to step in and assist them in that. There again, I think that's, again, part of management. You want the thing to succeed. So you have to come up with creative ways of how you're going to do that.
Yeah, so I'd I'd strongly encourage just have this part of your policies and procedures that you do have, because it's one thing to tell people, hey, you can't fill up your carport with household goods.
Yes.
But the fact of the matter is they really do need to have a place.
Yes.
And these people are the people that we want to help, and we want them to live there, but we also want to respect the rest of the neighborhood.
And I think what Eric said is very important to remember, and that is we're looking at this as a template for infill.
Okay, right.
So we can add and subtract to the concepts that are here. So what will work on this in this particular area is going to work in other areas too.
Okay.
So I think, again, the beginning part is it's how you set it up, and you make it very clear for people coming in, and you manage it.
Okay, thanks.
So,
okay, go ahead.
I'm just wondering here, you talked about one way of managing the load on the parking is by choosing tenants who are likely to have lower parking needs, and one category is seniors. Is there anything else you can do in terms of choosing the tenants who will have inherently lower parking needs, perhaps young children as opposed to older children?
I want to, before Larry answers directly, I want to get back to the one of the things, and we've seen this a lot with infill projects, is that this is not a commuter-based project. That part of this site is quite unique. It's close into town, and so by virtue of a combination of seniors that will have different driving needs, but also young families that are, you know, bicycles are pretty good to get around this town. They're great, right? And so in a sense, because we have an infill, we see that, I mean, San Francisco's extreme, but there, for example, most of the housing projects that are going in right now, they don't have any parking, right? And of course, any San Franciscan that would look at Lower Washington Street wouldn't see a parking problem. But, but you know, part of this is that by having, you know, sidewalks, which we have, by having bicycle trails, bicycle parking, and most importantly, the close proximity nature, that I think some of this is going to happen naturally, what you're talking about, that by getting the diversity, that not everybody will do it, but there will be some people that, regardless of the rules or what do, it's such a great box site. So.
Well, again, as CEH goes into the senior study, as I begin already working on that. The parking issue is really an interesting one. In the three senior parks, the average car per unit right now is a little over one. Okay. And yet, when I do the survey of it, you're probably going to have 25% to 30% that have no cars. And so, I want to investigate that a little bit more and get that down. The idea of putting seniors in here is not just for parking. The idea is to have multi-generational. It makes a better community type thing. But it has a side benefit that some of your little community don't have a high need for vehicles. So one hand is, I think, helping the other type thing.
I have a question. Could you go to the very last slide? And now, one of the main concerns of the danger of this driver, cars backing in, backing out, and now, what plan? The new design also utilizes 5-foot setback Napa River floodplain area, formerly family recreational activities with emphasis on younger children by placing recreational and type in that setting. This to me is pretty critical. Get the kids out of that driveway. And I guess everyone beat to that. But my concern here is this sounds great, but this is of Fish and Game. I mean, I don't know if this is possible.
You're absolutely right. Right, for starters, it is.
To me, this entire project hinges.
Well, so you can't build things there. Like, if we wanted to put parking there, for example, like asphalt, you can't do that, right? But you can certainly use it as in terms of like having picnic tables or a play area. You can landscape it. You just can't.
Well, I beg to differ. That's my that Fish and Game. Not very tolerant. I mean, I'm just.
They're not. Okay. And you're absolutely right that, for example, remember we have a 35-foot setback from the top of bank. Once you get to the bank, I completely agree. Bank on down, you really can't touch anything, right? And we will have to work with Fish and Game on the first 35 feet. But typically that deals with pervious surfaces and permanent kinds of alterations, so that if you're looking at, which is what we mentioned, like picnic tables or people using that, or even potentially the bike path, right? Something that's a low impact thing, that is a There are a lot of examples where it has happened. It doesn't mean that it won't be difficult to get it. So I totally agree with your.
Well.
Because it is a challenge.
Yeah. And I think that maybe it certainly have come. But this sort of. And I would think maybe want to sue this. Seriously, and the only reason I mention it is at our last meeting we dealt with another project on Upper Washington.
Right.
And apparently they have run into some real snags because they were thinking of sort of a similar use to, you know, it's the same river, it's the same setback.
Right.
Physically. So I would just caution you that to me this is a very critical part of this plan. I mean, these kids have to have some safe that can't be taken away from them. So, you know, that's a suggestion.
I think it's a really good, and as you know, it's a lengthy process with Fish and Game.
I understand that. All of these things are lengthy processes, but I would hate to be in a situation a year from now and having you come back and say, well, we have this project ready to go, but unfortunately, it's minus. Then we're the bad. You have to make. I would rather.
Okay.
Because it is, to me, it's a big issue. And I don't know, you know, but like I say, you've come a long way on this from. And I would hate to see it wind up sort of because of this. I mean, you know, I'm not like a fan of it. I'm not a fan of Caltrans either. But there's a bureaucracy that we have a lot of.
I totally agree with that. I mean, I've been helping a church in Montclair, been tied up for 5 years.
Yeah, no, I can.
For Creek. So, I believe I've been living your concern on something else. So.
Okay, that's
Do you think that the children will not play there? Can they landscape it? That be?
I don't know.
Because they don't care whether there's picnic tables there or not.
That I don't, really don't. They're pretty protective. That's fine. So I don't, I mean, anyone else?
Yeah, I think that's a great point, that we refresh that point, because that was, I think all of us agreed that this area in between these units, you know, with vehicles moving in and out and all hours of day and night, and with, you know, support garbage vehicles, so forth, it's an area that's it could be made safer, and obviously the safe areas out here closer to the river. Maybe there'll right. be some places. You know, I'd even see out there maybe a couple bicycle lockup boxes for kids. You know, where their families can lock their bikes in at night out there. But because I can just see that thing out there full of tricycles and bicycles and big wheels and whatever they ride these days, and it's pretty small congested area. So. I don't know, it's a chicken and egg. I don't know what's going to come first. It's like, is it fishing game or is it Calistoga Planning Commission? I'm not sure which, but
it's well, I think
an open parallel.
You each have a different lens, right? Yeah. Fish and Game oddly looks at it just from their purview, right, which is different. And in our experience dealing with them, because I've run into them off and on, obviously, is that they're very protective about their setbacks,
yeah.
can't do massive grading.
Right.
Can't then like concrete and pave, but picnic tables and that sort of thing they generally don't care about because it doesn't really affect the riverbank. So I mean that's been our experience, but yeah. point is well taken. So
I just wanted
so
to.
So I think what Chairman Manfredi is kind of giving you a heads up on is that if that should come to pass that we don't have satisfactory areas for basically public safety, it could be a deal breaker. I think for you, I think because most people so. So thank you.
Are the 35-foot natural setback, is that, do you feel that that's adequate for that? For the playing area and that type of thing? I think we can solve the one with Fish and Game, but as he said, you never know until you get a sign on the dotted line. But our conversations with him so far has been, you know, don't disturb things. You make it look nice, but when it comes up to that riverbank itself, they want it pretty much staying the way it is,
yeah.
following down. But my concern is that we get that arranged. Is that you think that's sufficient for a play area?
So I'd answer in a performance base rather than a prescriptive base. I mean, if in everyone's judgment it's sufficiently attractive that the kids are more likely to go play there than play in the asphalt.
Yep.
So, and they cut you off 5 feet, but you can get some, I don't know, temporary wooden play structure that makes it attractive for them.
Make it attractive so it's fun to play there. That's where they're going to go. Yep. The other thing is that I think that this whole area needs to maybe take better use of the ball field that's at the end. I think it's a natural for that whole area. And we wouldn't be opposed to even putting some money into helping to expand that particular area because the older students, older kids, that's where they need to be going, the ball field area.
Carol has.
Just a comment and a question. I think the kids are gonna play on the asphalt no matter where it is. That's what kids do, so. What's the distance between the parking spaces, the green belt, and the building? How far is that?
It's about 15 feet.
Okay.
What we did, just so that, basically took out the backyards, right, from the previous scheme. So we've gone pretty tight to the side yard setbacks, which is the 5-foot side yard setback. That's what gave us additional space so that we have enough room to kind of get actually a landscaped area that is wide enough to get a path, trees, kind of to get so kids and people can walk comfortably back and the site. So that's where the space came from. This was the backyard.
Another issue that came up the last time was trash.
So the trash actually moved to the back corner. To right back there. So, and because we talked about a lot of things, and part of it was we looked at, for example, you could put it up here, but we're spending all of this effort to make Washington Street attractive and a nice pedestrian environment. And like, This afternoon when I went by, there were like 20 trash cans right out on the street here. And that's not very nice, you know, and so that doesn't really work. And so part of what we looked at was getting it as far away from the most number of tenants as possible, just because it'll be, you know, between recycling, all these different things, right? And so there's an enclosure in the back. So that's where it went.
And just so you know, this issue came up with the Ferris project. That's why it's Ferris.
Yeah, exactly. Because they happened to have them all out, and it was a real mess. So this afternoon,
is anyone in?
If I could ask one last one. So, is there such a number that you keep track of that gives you square feet per occupant on all these units? So you got one bedroom, two bedrooms. Do you have a average square foot per occupant number, or how much living space are we talking about for these units internally?
We are talking about they're around, the two bedroom units are around 900 plus square feet. So
I'm sorry.
950 square feet roughly.
Okay.
So they vary a little bit, part of because we went to different unit types.
Mm-hmm.
The one bedroomer, let me get my sheet here. I think the one bedroom is around 750 is what I'm remembering.
About 750, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So having said that, I mean, so in a typical two-bedroom, how many occupants would you consider that suitable for in a one-bedroom? I mean, are we talking about two people per bedroom in a unit?
Yeah, you're talking basically for a two-bedroom or something like Sonoma Commons. It's probably 3 to 4 people for a two-bedroom apartment. It depends a little bit on, obviously, like the senior two-bedroom apartment. It's going to be lower. You know, some of them, if there's one kid, it'll be 3. If it's, so it's going to vary a little bit.
Is there an industry standard that in your business that people come up with to say, in building these kind of units, there's kind of a minimum?
It does vary a lot by area.
Uh-huh.
So when you get into bigger cities, it's really tight. You can get, I mean, I just know we were doing some housing in Cincinnati, and our developer was from New York. He kept insisting that we get 3 bedrooms in about 1,000 to 1,100 square feet, which Cincinnati market will not go for. So it varies a lot by area. But around this area, 900 to 1,000 is pretty good for a two-bedroom apartment.
And how about the features? All these, we're using dual pane soundproof windows, which I guess are pretty much standard these days.
Well, the soundproof is a separate category. Dual pane insulated is pretty standard.
Okay.
Because it's potentially modular construction,
yeah.
You actually, one of the benefits that you get is that you get double wall construction. So if you remember the photo that had that unit coming,
mm-hmm.
Each unit has its own set of walls. So the floor is built twice, right? Because the downstairs unit has its own ceiling.
Right.
So you get an airspace. So your sound rating between units is just by default is incredibly good.
Okay.
I mean, it's kind of ideal, actually. But that's just a function. That's just a byproduct of using a modular system. So
are there any features that we should know? I mean, so I assume they're air conditioned, they're garbage disposals, there's
well, this is pretty early, but in terms of space planning, there's a washer dryer each unit, which is a nice thing.
Each unit will have a washer and dryer?
There's space for it right now, yes.
I mean, but that comes with the unit, so these are going to be like stackables or something probably?
That's exactly what's planned. In terms of space, right?
Okay.
We haven't talked about, but yeah, there's space for a stacked washer dryer, and
Yeah, but there's space, but or they'll actually, but will they actually be part of the accommodations for people that move in there, or do they have to provide their own?
They'll be in.
They'll be in. They'll be installed, right? So I'm looking for people that might have to, they have families and, okay. All right. So there's nothing that's, so it's pretty much up to most of the modern features that you expect in a.
It's actually, I mean, in terms of compared to most housing, it's going to be way more insulation, better windows, better thermal, just because that's the current code, right, at a minimum.
Yeah.
And it'll have more efficient lighting. It'll have all the kind of the typical closet space that you would expect for really any. There's nothing about these units, actually, that is particularly different because they're affordable.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was getting to. If there's
there's nothing really different. I would say the bigger difference is that we need to get this number of units on the site to keep it affordable. That's really what's driving it. And so the units themselves, these are very similar to the units that we did for the cottages at Southbridge, which are pretty darn expensive units. So there's not a whole lot of difference there. They don't have fireplaces. I would say that's the one thing that's right. Different. So.
Good, thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. Anyone else in the audience like press? Nice comment.
Good evening, Bob Fitteman, 1300 Cedar Street. Many of you, I'm sure, are aware that I founded Calistoga Affordable Housing about 12 years ago. I've been gone for 3 years, so I'm not really active with the company anymore, but very interested still to see their progress. I'm happy to see somebody else dealing with all the issues. I might mention that CAH, we looked at this site for years. In fact, I think we had offers on it a couple of times several years ago. This is one of the very few sites in town that really makes terrific sense for an affordable housing project. And I would have to say that the last project I worked on was CAH was in a location that quite a few people didn't really like. I think just about all those people told me, why don't you build it down on Washington Street? So here you are with an opportunity, I think, to give a thumbs up to what I consider to be a very an excellent project and one that has been substantially improved from the July meeting, which I was sorry to miss since I was on vacation. So I think you've contributed a lot to this project status at this point with the suggestions that you had. And I think that the architect and CAH have been very responsive to those comments. You've got a really good design firm here. Very prestigious, and I think it shows in what they've laid out. You've got a revised layout, but there was a suggestion that the project be flipped with the three-story buildings on the south side, and that's been done. You've got different roof profiles, you've got garage doors, deeper balconies. There's a whole bunch of things that have been done, I think, to make this a much better project. I think compared to anything else on Washington Street today, this will be the nicest quality project there. The comments on density, you know, everybody always wants low density. This is not a high density project. This is all my years of apartment investment and development. This is a medium density project. It's below what the city's requirement is for an affordable housing project from a standpoint of density. And It is what it is. Density all ties back to the cost of the land. Land in Calistoga is expensive, and the cost per unit is a huge factor. I congratulate, actually, CAH has looked at modular construction for years, and it's been done quite a bit in affordable housing. I've seen lots of projects, Seattle, Oakland, various places. They're good looking. You don't even know that they're modular construction when they're completed. And it's one of the ways to keep the construction costs down. So I guess I'm urging you to, you know, show this project some support. I think it's a good one. And lots of comments about parking. I think there's been a real response to decrease the parking demand by making some of the units senior units. I would remind you, I know it's a very different situation, but the Squire project just up the street, as far as I can see, has zero parking, 14 units with zero parking. Doesn't seem to present an untenable problem. I drove by there this afternoon. Lots of spaces left on the street, but that's all off-site parking there, 100%. And I think what you did with that project was a good thing. It's really good to see that rebuilt. I guess I'd point
Actually,
out.
Actually, we didn't really have anything. Thank you. Just so you know.
Well, it went to the Planning Commission 2011 for the. Pardon?
Part of it.
Well, yeah, the new building. One that fronts on Washington. And I was going to mention, you brought up unit sizes. The units in that project are half the size of what the two bedroom units proposed here would. So, affordable housing is not easy, as I'm sure you all know. In the 10 years I was active with Calistoga Affordable Housing, we only built 42 units, Calistoga, two projects. Remodeled another 8 units, but took 10 years to get two projects done. So here's an opportunity, and I do hope that you will show this project some support. I think it will upgrade Washington Street, and I hope that it will eventually get what's it going to need? Final design review and a use permit. So I hope it's on track that direction. Thank you.
Thanks for your comment. Anyone else?
Clarence Levisi, 285 Rosedale Road. I guess the first thing I want to say is I really want a copy of your. I thought that was fantastic. Covered all kinds of topics, all kinds of areas, and in an incredible balance. 30 years ago, Citizens Committee discussed Lower Washington in the future. And this is exactly what the discussions were always about. Multi-usage, multi-families, multi-processes, not having just a business park, or an industrial area, or a housing area, but something that had mixed. And there's been numerous studies and numerous experiments where you have the mixed generational, and this is the demonstrated advantages of that is just incredible. And there's plenty of research out there to underscore that. So I think that's absolutely. Great. I think the idea of the modular, I don't know how that's going to work with the building guidelines that we have in Calistoga, whether there's going to have to be some PD adjustments or something else to make sure that modular can be used. but that is a terrific, and that is cutting edge in where we're going, and with high quality. The high quality of modular building is incredible today. In many ways, more so than sometimes having a builder build it. I think that what Larry has said, I want to underscore, this appears to me to be an incredibly well-balanced, well-presented plan that can, in the future, be used as a basis for looking at any other plan and then looking at these elements and saying all of these elements need to be there. And how do we put them in balance in this new situation? Yeah, fish and game, I would only agree that from the ranch stuff that I read and everything, fish and game has gotten a lot tighter. And so I hang in there and good negotiating. And, I would suggest too, also the question was raised about storage. I think it's important to go the extra mile to put the storage areas that you can there. But I love the suggestion about working something out where people could get an advantage and not have to rack their brains or I'm not sure what terminology to use, but feel really under a great deal of pressure to try and figure out where to store their stuff if there was an agreement where they could get reasonable storage just a little ways across the street. Having had rentals for 30 years, I know all about the storage stuff, and it's really true. Thank you.
Thanks, Clarence. Anyone else? Okay, I'll open it up to discussion. Clarify.
Are we trying to summarize our comments for the applicant?
Yes.
Okay.
I have a list.
I think you've done a great job in addressing many of the issues that we raised, and I thank you for the work that you've done. I think there are a lot of aspects of the project which are great. I think the mixed use, the frontage on the Washington Street, slight reduction in density are all great. And I saw your note. I don't think I personally, the rest of the commissioners, need convincing about the need this type of housing in town. We want to make this work. My only concern remains practically how it will work. You are low on parking, and the parking that you've got is tandem, which is a difficult type of parking to utilize fully. And I think that's the biggest challenge that remains. I'm open to listening and hearing at the point of asking for a specific entitlement, a detailed management and tenant occupancy plan that could show how that worked. And if it can be shown that will work without significant overspill on Washington, I'd be supportive. But I'm not sure, I can't quite see how it will work at the moment. And to pick up on Chairman Manfredi's remarks, I think the necessity of having some form of play space at the back is an absolute. That falls apart as well.
Thank you. Good.
Just a few things. I encourage you to create as much storage space as you possibly can. I know that's an extra added expense, but I think that would make a huge difference. I do think you have room for one more parking space after number 30. It's probably one more can be fit in there. That corner. Yeah. And I know, because I just recently walked Rancho, that a lot of senior citizens either have no car or there's one car. So I'm fairly comfortable with the four units having only one space. And I really think you did a great job. You've improved this dramatically, and I love the idea of multi-generational, multi-use. Thank you.
I'm actually for this. I just have a few comments. One, I would reiterate what Kite mentioned. In our previous meeting, with proposing the up on Upper Washington, they apparently have a very strict tenant lease where the way they explained it, since there's such a demand for these apartments, don't buy, they're out. And it's all about the things we're talking about. So I you know, if you do get that far where you're supporting, that would be something I would like to see. What, how this is managed. You know, we're going out on a limb here because we sort of told this group that they need to supply adequate quiet code. If you can come up with one more parking place, that would be great. Another possibility, and I know it's difficult from the financial end, were to eliminate one more unit and put in one more mixed use component, less in parking. It's just a thought. I'm not saying it's going to have to satisfy me, but parking is, we're aware of it. As far as putting doors on the garages, I'm not too sure that makes sense, because I think it would then just make it easier for them to come. And it's an added expense.
It is an added expense, but I think aesthetically, I think it will help from the character standpoint.
Okay.
I think one of the things that I think would help the commission is that when we come back with the proper documentation things, I think it'd be well if we had in place there a management plan, totally management plan, how we intend to manage these things. Because to me, all this is a management issue. And I think it would be helpful. We just showed you this is how we intend to do it. We'll be able to have legal people look at it and say, yeah, you can do this.
And you did say there is an on-site manager.
There is going to be an on-site manager, yes.
Okay, thanks. So if there's nothing else, I think we've given you some nice advice in our opinion. The staff has anything to add? Look forward to your next go around. Thank you. So, do any commissioners have anything they'd like to bring up? I'd like to welcome Walter back.
Thank you.
And any comments, project status?
Just one at your next meeting, November 14th, we will have the Indian Springs expansion proposal for you.
Anything from you, Eric? Is there a score?
Giants are up 5-0.
So I make a motion that we adjourn tonight's meeting to the next regularly scheduled Planning Commission meeting of November 14th.
Second.
All in favor? Aye. All opposed? 5-0.